Okay. Welcome.
Whoa.
So tonight I thought we would, you need to, I don't like that either. I'm going to put this down. I don't know what I don't like, but I don't like it. Okay. Yeah. So something I thought would be fun to do tonight, well, not fun, but cool or nice or appropriate, whatever the right words are, is to read the Christmas story. I don't know about your family, but we read the Christmas story. Sitting around the tree and around the room before we open any presents. It's a fun tradition we do. So, and we're just going to do, I'm going to read exactly what we read as a family. So we'll be in Luke chapter 2. You got a big enough Bible there, Joyce? Joyce, do you need a bigger Bible, Joyce? Joyce, I'm talking into the microphone and you can't hear me. Oh.
It would be a lot better to just do this, wouldn't it?
Yes, it would. What are
you? Is it possible to turn off the house and just have it go through the system? Okay. Luke 2. So Luke chapter 1 is really about, are you two okay? Are you all right? Yeah? Do you need a pregnant pillow or anything? Or? I think Lauren has one. I'm going to hopefully let it go.
Just let it go.
Okay. Luke chapter 1 is about Elizabeth and John, Mary visiting John, all that good stuff. Then John is born at the end of Luke chapter 1. Zacharias prophesies, gets his voice back. It's all good. Did you know that there were 80 verses in Luke chapter 1? An interesting little piece of trivia. I think it's one of the biggest books of the New Testament. I'm pretty sure it is. So, anyway, so in Luke chapter 2, now in those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that a census be taken of all the inhabited earth. Isn't that pretty interesting? The whole earth. He wanted it. Yeah, it was quite the process. And one of the ways you did that, you find out, is you all go back to your town of your birth. Yeah, and you registered there. And that's how they got back to where, to Bethlehem. This was the first census taken while Quirinus was governor of Syria. And everyone was on his way to register for the census, each to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the city of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David. This is probably an important thing, and I'm sure most of us know this, but it's just good to repeat that it'd be good sometime for us to study the seed line of Jesus, all the way from Adam to Joseph. It's listed in Matthew for you. You can look at that. But just so you guys understand that Joseph was of the line of David. David was of the line of Judah. Judah was of the line. Just, you can follow that all the way back. And it's a pretty interesting study sometime for you to do to see how the bloodline and who it goes through and some of the incredible history that's there. Ruth and Boaz and Bathsheba. It's a pretty interesting lineage to look at. And so David is of the line, which is pretty interesting because Mary isn't, but Joseph's blood is not involved. Isn't that kind of interesting? Yeah. City of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David, in order to register along with Mary, who was engaged to him and was with child. And while they were there, the days were completed for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son. And she wrapped him in cloths, laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. I read this today for a while, and it just seems there should be more fanfare. I feel like there should be more incredible things that are said here, and it just says, she had a baby. You know, it's like the simplicity of the arrival. And I mean, there's been sermons all around this story, so I don't want you guys to, honestly, I don't want to overly sensationalize this tonight. I really just wanted to talk about it and read this together and think about the honest simplicity of the coming of the Lord. Yes, there was prophecy. Yes, an angel appeared to Mary and to Joseph. Yes, even an angel appeared to Zacharias and all of this, but the beauty of this is when it actually took place, the simplicity and the humility of it in a manger, which is basically a stall, an outside stall, among animals. So those, you know, all those Christmas plays that you were involved in when you were little or your kids were involved in later. Sorry, we don't do that here. Those are all exactly right. All among the animals and among the most humble base things of the current reality, Jesus enters this world. And if you really think about it, there were more animals around him than there were people around him when he arrived. I think it just kind of speaks to the lack of fanfare, though angels appear to shepherds, we're about to find out. I'm impressed by the lack of required of Jesus' arrival. Yeah. Absolutely. And actually even less so, because I don't think that this is a regular kind of birth. I don't think many babies were going to be born this way. So I love it. I think the simplicity of this is beautiful, which I think is often in stark contrast to a lot of what we see in the church today. I think there is an awful lot of emphasis on things that don't matter very much. And this is Mark's opinion. But to see the simplicity of the Son coming is beautiful to me. In the same region, there were some shepherds staying out in the fields and keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly frightened. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today, in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you, that you will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there appeared with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest." Now this, there are a few places where I don't like the New American Standard, and this is one of them, because of what it's translated next. Verse 14 in the NAS says, "And on earth, peace among men with whom he is pleased." Do you guys see that? It gives the idea that God is only speaking peace on earth among the people that he's pleased with. And so I want to tell you, I spent about an hour today studying the original language here in the Greek. And that is not what it says. Actually, the more literal and I actually went to some of the, like the Young's literal translation. I went to the Greek lexicon and read this. And it literally means that goodwill toward everyone. And the verse right before it even says that. This is good news for how many people? All the people. It's not just for Jews. Although, you know, I'm sure these shepherds were Jewish. I'm sure that most of the people that were aware of his arrival were Jewish. And we also find out later in this chapter that wise men came from where? The East. And it's pretty well established by both Jewish rabbis and otherwise that they were not Jewish wise men that came. They were men of other beliefs and other tongues. So this is really important. Verse 14, glory to God in the highest, peace on earth. And if your Bible says goodwill toward men, that's what it should say. Yeah. That's the right translation. In fact, I don't feel like opening this up, but it actually says peace on earth to men. The Greek then just says goodwill. Which means if you read it like a Greek, it would say peace on earth and with all men goodwill toward you. That's actually like how a Greek would say it if you read it in the original language. So for me, what I love about this idea of Jesus, and it's really hard to understand to a Jew, but Jesus comes for all mankind. And that is one of the most heretical things about Jesus, both in the original kind of proclamation of his birth, all the way into his life and ministry up to the crucifixion, is that he wasn't just for Jews. And what's crazy is most of the Jews rejected him. Most of the Jews would say, especially to this day, how many millions of Jews would still say they're waiting on a Messiah. So the beauty of this, and we find out later when Paul talks about that, we were grafted in because the Jews wouldn't receive or couldn't believe. This is really, in my mind, this declaration of the angel to the shepherds says to all of mankind that from here on out, and I think, didn't Andrew Womack say something along these lines? That, yeah, I remember him teaching this, that this statement here now colors the rest of history going forward, that this is the attitude of God toward man going forward. That from here on out, the attitude and heart of God toward man is peace and goodwill. If you ever wanted to question what the thoughts of God are concerning mankind, concerning the earth, concerning humanity, this is it. And Jesus coming as a child is the proof positive of that belief, of that heart attitude. And we find out later when Jesus actually says, for God so loved the world that he gave his son. So not only is there peace and goodwill that he's hoping for, or peace that he's hoping for and goodwill that he has toward them, but it's flat out agape toward all of mankind. You got thoughts yet? Ben, anything? You got a microphone there? Right. So, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom God is pleased. I also feel like verse 14, you know, is kind of a stepwise approach. Glory to God first in the highest places, in the heavens, and then also on earth, that peace that accompanies God, as well as the goodwill that he has, is toward the earth too. So not only on heaven anymore, but also now on earth is the glory of God. Verse 15, when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds began saying to one another, let us go straight to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. So they came in a hurry and found their way to Mary and Joseph and the baby as he lay in the manger. And when they had seen this, they made known the statement which had been told them about this child. And all who heard it wondered at the things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary, again, treasured all these things, pondering them in her heart. This is like at least the second time that we hear this phrase about Mary, that she both treasured these things and pondered them in her heart. I think it's a window into not only Mary, but also the feminine side of humanity. The idea of when you hear a thing or when you experience a thing, ladies will treasure it in their hearts, especially something along the lines of a child that they're going to bring forth from their own body. Hearing the angel say who this child is going to be and the value that he will be to the earth. And then to have angels tell shepherds on a hillside that your child is born and this is a sign of the peace on earth and goodwill toward men. She hears this about her own child. And I mean, I know I have several moms in this room. When you hear something said about your child that's positive and good, it goes straight to the deepest parts of who you are and it lodges there. And you treasure that forevermore. And so when people come and say, I just got to tell you what we heard about your son. I mean, it's just, it does something in her. And also, it speaks to the quality of a woman. How the heart of a woman is a treasure chest. And, you know, us guys, we would be really wise to remember that idea. That what we say is stored up. What is heard, especially, you know, emotionally charged things and things that are of great importance about them or their children or the things that are valuable to them, those are stored up in the hearts of a lady. And I'll tell you how you discover this. Get into a disagreement with them. You'll be amazed at what they remember. Ladies, come on. Us guys, we forget 5 or 10 minutes later. We're not as good as storing up in our hearts and treasuring and pondering things. But man, you ladies, you have this quality about you. You know, it's similar to how you take that seed of man and you store that seed on the inside of you and you combine it with yourself and bring forth something. We just, you know, we've talked about this before. We give you a little swimmer and 9 months later, you give us this incredibly intricate creature. How do you do that? That's incredible. But you do the same thing with everything given to you. You know, we've talked about this before too, but I think it bears repeating. If we give a lady just a little bit of love, a swimmer worth of love, you will grow that over time and give us this beautifully intricate creature of love. If we give you, you know, caring or understanding or whatever that is, you'll give that back to us bigger and more developed than we gave it to you. And in the same way, if we give you anger, if we give you resentment, if we give you ignoring you, that all gets built up and stored up too. Am I speaking truth or? Yeah.
So I'm going to say something because it's the... At this point, is the story about Jesus in the context of what was happening around him? And then after this, it starts being about him, like circumcision and all of that. So I'd like to make a little line here. Now, it's so interesting that the census happened because the father was about to reconnect humanity to their original place of birth, himself. And so the whole nation of Israel gets reconnected to their original physical place of birth. So you have this similarity happening. And it's basically the inception of a new lineage, of a new spiritual dynasty, so to speak, from the place where David started his dynasty and his lineage. So this is like something that is happening, like a divinely appointed thing at the biggest known empire of the time, dictating this for taxation purposes, because they want their money from all the families. But the Lord is at the same time using this. Like, I want everybody to be accounted for and everybody to reconnect to their original place of birth. But he's saying this about humanity as well. And it's so interesting that the people of Israel, the census for them was a huge deal. You could even see how David got in trouble once that he tried to do a census, and he paid dearly because it was, you cannot count something that does not belong to you. So if I come to your house and start counting all your money, you'd be like, what are you doing? That's not yours. Where, what are you even, are you the IRS or something? So when, every time that there was a census, every single person had to give a ransom for themselves and present it to the Lord. But this time they didn't, because the ransom for their life was actually being birthed. It was Jesus. So it's so interesting when you start seeing the parallels of what was happening. Basically, you would give this ransom for the tabernacle, for the temple. And actually, the temple was being birthed, just in the flesh, right? He was the tabernacle. We also see how this I was reading somebody about the first thing that we actually own is our body. So the first ownership we ever experience is our physical body, with all the properties that come with that, mental, emotional, and that. So we actually see how finally, for the first time, like, God had a body. So that it might be a tiny little detail how it says it here. Like, yeah, she had a baby, wrapped him up, put him in a manger. And it's like Mark was saying, it's so matter-of-factly. And it's one of the biggest deals in, you know, in eternity. It's like, okay, God has a body. Human body. So, you know, it's not a small thing. And he is the firstborn among many brethren, the first incarnation of sonship, the first son of God, son of man fully. So it's like this complete change is happening in the most simple way. I like the fact that the angels appear to shepherds and the flocks, because when you see that, the leaders of Israel were always called, you know, in the Old Testament, the shepherds, and the sheep were the people. So for the first time, like, the Lord is also using this prophetic analogy and saying the first people I want to tell these to are actually the leaders, are actually the shepherds. And it's so interesting, they left their flocks and went straight to see him, to see the baby, which is, well, I won't get into that, but it's so amazing how we sometimes think that our main responsibility is towards the flock, and actually it should be towards Jesus being released and Jesus being manifested. That's the first thing we should, like, always run to see. So far, those are the things that one more thing would be this treasuring things in her heart that Mark was mentioning. I actually went and looked that up because it says it several times, but every time it's a different term. And in this particular term, it's used only three times in the Bible. And one of these times is when it says you need to put new wine in a new wineskin. So the wine will not spoil, but it will be preserved. And this word preserved is this word treasure. It's like almost my heart becomes the wineskin for this new wine. So it's not just preserving, but it actually acquires value in time. It just gets better. This just kind of struck me how she had this capacity of holding that wine and protecting it and preserving it.
Any other thoughts?
Jump with me over to Matthew. Because as Gabby said, from here, it kind of goes into Jesus being presented at the temple. It kind of takes a leap and goes into his younger years, some of the things that happened, some of the prophecies, and we can get to that. But in Matthew, this is right after one of the two genealogies that are given about Jesus. One of them is in Matthew, and then the other one is in Luke chapter 3. Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. This is another account. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit. And Joseph, her husband, being a righteous man and not wanting to disgrace her, planned to send her away secretly. But when he had considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child who has been conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. I tell you what, that's tough. Every time I read that, I'm just like, man. For an engaged guy to hear that about his fiance is just, I mean, just from a real standpoint, just think about it. You know, and he was like being a gentleman here. I'm just going to put you away quietly. Putting away just simply means I'm going to separate and let you go back to your house with your parents. Yeah. Yeah. That put away actually means that. Yeah. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. And now all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, behold, the virgin shall be with child and shall bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel. And I believe that's from Isaiah. Let me confirm that.
Isaiah
7:14. Yep, 7:14, right. Which translated means God with us. We've talked a lot about that here over the last couple of weeks. That is important, but you've heard that already. Joseph awoke from his sleep and did as the angel of the Lord commanded him and took Mary as his wife, but kept her a virgin until she gave birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. That's beautiful. Just think about, you know, he hears from the angel of the Lord that she is with child, conceived by the Lord. And it's almost like how do you walk with one who has been that intimate with the Lord? Just, he's walking with her now in such a way where he actually says, I won't be intimate with her at all. It says he kept her a virgin until she had birthed a child. I don't know, I sense like this holy awe that Joseph has concerning his wife now. That there is this woman who has been overshadowed by the Holy Spirit, has conceived. I mean, you have to hear this story by faith. It's one of the things I'm continually impressed by. That this is a story of faith. You have to just read this and believe that the Lord loves people this much, that there's this overshadowing of a woman, and there's nothing sexual about this at all. There is this idea that he implants himself inside of a woman. There's no sexual act that takes place here. That's a very important thing for you guys to understand. She was a virgin when she had this child. This is important. So her, what's that? You know, that seal was broken in birth. Think about that. That seal was not broken in conception. There's a lot that can be said about that prophetically. You know, the idea of Jesus being the one. God had to initiate the reconciliation of man. So he breaks the barrier. Man doesn't break the barrier. You see that? And as Joseph is walking with her, he so treasures, almost as if he's walking around with heaven itself. Just think about it. Heaven contained the Lord up until this time where man then contains the Lord. And so he begins to walk with literally a physical, natural representation of the heavenly dimension, because inside of her is the Lord himself. And man, just, we don't know exactly when he was told this versus her conception, or do we know that? No, yeah. So it might have been 6 or 7 months that he knew this, maybe 8 or 9, who knows. But for some period of time, he's walking with her knowing that she's carrying the Son of God. It's just I'm amazed by that idea. I'm just trying to think of myself as a husband, how I would be treating Dawn. I'd be like making sure no one ever touched her or ran into her. I'd like wrap her in bubble wrap or something. I don't know what I'd do. So it's just beautiful.
It's this, I was thinking the whole time about this being overshadowed because you only see that word three times in the Bible, and it one time is with Mary, second time is when the Father appeared to Jesus when he was baptized, and the third time is in the Mount of Transfiguration. It's like three times when this overshadowing occurs, and it's actually so interesting that it's very vague as a term, which just means you're being covered by a shadow, but actually it's wrapped with light because the shadow is not really a shadow, but it's the glory. So it's like you're now this, how, if you see at these three stages of the life of Jesus, when he was conceived, when he was ushered into his real identity as a son and released into it, and then when he revealed his real nature to his disciples. So it's like these three moments when the Father actually overshadowed the natural, because what this overshadowing means is that the spiritual goes beyond nature. It's like literally it becomes more real than the natural form. And to me, that is like every time I think what the Bible says, that the same Spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead shall quicken your mortal bodies, is the only way that I believe we can release Jesus, is that actually the Spirit inside of us is released through the flesh, which is a miracle in itself, that what that life itself can be released through something that is dead, basically, because it's the flesh is dead, the Spirit is life. And how this virginity of not being, I don't think it had to do with the moral aspect too much, but rather the aspect of not being touched by man, that path was not opened by a human. It was opened by God himself. You know, he created that path. He created that life. And it's, you know, if you see the Father revealing himself so powerfully in the Mount of Transfiguration and the baptism of Jesus, and before it even started, to Mary herself. Like, you know, the Holy Spirit will overshadow, no, the power of God will overshadow you. It's like this amazing thing where the living glory of the Father just completely, I don't even know how to explain it, but it's like if I think of how man was created from dust, and then this power came through. And I believe in that glory, we would have created beings that carried the same glory. But when we lost that glory, all we could create was just flesh. We could only reproduce that flesh. We could not reproduce the glory anymore. And this is when it's reversed. This is when that fall was reversed with the birth of Jesus, because what he is doing is bringing us back to the beginning through this act. So it's like so much more than just, oh yeah, there's a, here, it happened without sexual act. It's really this overshadowing. It's like, I'm going to go past the nature, past your flesh, and just release a mean for you to have that glory back. And it, to me, is like one of the most meaningful things of the birth of Jesus, is that finally our mortal bodies basically had a way to go back to that glory.
Yeah, that reminds me of the verse in Hebrews where it says that he made the visible out of that which was invisible. So if you go back to Genesis, he didn't make anything out of what already was. He made things from himself, specifically man. And to Gabby's point, we see that again here. He doesn't need human seed to create here. He uses himself. But in this case, he partners with a woman to create this. But the beauty of it is, and I think it's to this point of restarting the start, kind of like similar to Genesis. But in my opinion, it's a much more connected way, where he could have just spoken a person into existence and formed him, and all of a sudden he shows up on the scene like a Melchizedek type person who has no genealogy, who has no father or mother, but instead he brings himself through someone who has genealogy that's connected all the way back. Does that make sense? Yeah, so I feel like it's a much more human way of divinely recreating the glory of God on the earth. And I love it. And I think it's the most beautiful story.
If you think about the first Adam, how he was fashioned, and the second Adam, how he was fashioned, it will give you that distinction, which is so radical. It's like incredibly, like even using that seed of Eve to, is like, you know, I gave you the earth and I'm going to partner with you to create the second Adam because I gave you earth. Right. So we're going to do this together. It's like how, and I think, because every time I think about the birth of Jesus, I don't think only about Jesus. I think about us and how sonship is being birthed in us. How, you know, like Paul says, I am in labor until Christ is formed in us. It's the same process of the same spirit that quickens, and that word means that brings life to our mortal flesh. I mean, I don't think there's any other way that Jesus can be released through a human flesh other than this happening, this overshadowing inside of us. That's how Jesus is born within every person. Now, I don't want to go all that way.
Well,
but it's
not a bad idea to do that, because that picture kind of gives that idea of the hands representing the overshadowing of the Lord, that this person from within comes alive and then must overcome the flesh that surrounds it. The glory almost within, yeah, beginning then to overcome the flesh that's without.
Yeah. And I it's so important also the fact of virginity, because if the seed comes from man, it's almost like that womb cannot bear, you know, something that is only from the Father. And Paul explains this so many times, but spirit begets spirit and flesh begets flesh, and you can't mix the two. So it's either spirit or it's flesh. And it's almost like in that case, you can't. Now the spirit can give life to the flesh, but the flesh can never give life to the spirit. So it needs to come from within, and it needs to be this divine seed inside of us. So every time I think about this and I think about Mary, I think about us and how sonship is birthed inside of each and every one of us. And I also think how this body, our mind, our thing, which is so, you know, you're made from dust, you return to dust. It's earthen vessels. It's all this. And still, it can release Jesus. It can release him through this, which is every time I think about it is just, I'm like, how can, but I think the transfiguration is that overshadowing where it's like manifested. And then finally the resurrection where it became fully manifest, like the body that we will have when we, you know, when we're with him. But I believe even now, even here, we can start experiencing that if we understand this overshadowing. And like today, I kept praying, you know, Lord, overshadow me. You know, go beyond my nature, the flesh. Go beyond that. Is I don't think we can birth the Son unless we are overshadowed by the Father. And where that deep identity comes from, it's, and I kept seeing this so much about, I mean, it's overwhelming to me that something physical, which is made of the same material, carbon of this piece of carpet or that thing of wood, we are the same material, and still we can release Jesus. We can release the Father in such a, and you know, it's crazy. So the birth of it, the sonship, and all of a sudden you have God who is a body owner. He owns a body, but he can't do anything with a body, so the mom is carrying him around and all that. So it's just amazing to see the stages of sonship and how the Father chose to create the second Adam, completely different than how he created the first.
Who else is thinking? Well, I mean, everybody's thinking. Is anybody thinking like they want to say something? Thank you, Jason. Yep. Is that where you want to go?
Yeah.
Why don't you take us, sir?
So in chapter 2, we go into the visit of the Magi. I think, like, if you're from a like a Hispanic culture or a Latin culture or, you know, Italian, this is like a major deal because we celebrate this almost, it's almost as big as Christmas Day. We celebrate like January 6th is the visit of the Magi, and that's when you really actually, for anyone who celebrates tradition, that's when you actually get your presents, and, you know, we do all that type of celebrating, and it's celebrated around this this story. Or this portion of the story. But now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, Magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. Which I will always question. I don't know, I don't have an answer for that one, but when it said all Jerusalem with him, I'm wondering, like, this news is getting out, like, and there's a troubling spirit around all of Jerusalem, and I wonder why. I think it's something that the Lord will reveal to me at one point. But
I think it's important that we ask, just so everyone, who is Herod?
He's the ruler of that area, like a governor, pretty much, Roman governor of that area.
He would consider himself a king.
Yeah.
Yeah. So when a king of the Jews hears that a king of the Jews is born, there's a little bit of threat. You know?
And I would understand totally from Herod's perspective. You're like, wait a minute. This is not from my line.
Yeah.
Because that's how it would work, right? Like, somebody from my line is going to take over the ruling of this land. But you're coming and telling me there's a king out there. That's unsettling. But now you have all of Jerusalem, they're unsettled too. And there's probably something unsettling when you're like, wait, there's a different king? This is not how we expected this to go down. Because there was plenty of expectations from the Jews on how their Messiah was going to come. So we'll go on. Gathering together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. And they said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea. For this is what had been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, land of Judah, are by no means least among the leaders of Judah. For out of you shall come forth a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Going back to what you're talking about. "Then Herod secretly called the Magi and determined from them the exact time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, 'Go and search carefully for the child. And when you have found him, report to me, so that I too may come worship him.' And after hearing the king, they went their way. And the star which I had seen in the east went on before them until it came and stood over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. After coming into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. And they fell to the ground and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they presented to him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned by God in a dream not to return to Herod, the Magi left for their own country by another way." I think the thing that impressed me today, really, in thinking about the Christmas story, was the extremely, like, contrasting experience of the shepherds and the Magi. And I think it's a it's really a picture of experiences that we should have. Because the shepherds had this, like, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, out of the blue experience, and they're, like, seeing angels, and they're like, we got to go do this thing. And it almost could feel like an emotional experience, right? Like, it comes out of nowhere, and I'm experiencing Jesus, and, like, people are singing, and the lights are... And then the Magi have this very, like, pragmatic, thought out, walked out, like, experience that brings them to the foot of Jesus. And I think for a balance in our lives, we kind of have to have both of those things. We have to have that time where it's like, whoa, Jesus just, like, the angels are showing up and we get to see Jesus and everything in all his glory. And then at the same time, we need to have that real, like, studied out, understanding, pragmatic point that we get to understand who Jesus is, and it brings us to the foot of Jesus. And I think it's really cool that both experiences are extremely valid, and both experiences are very, very important. And you could go and have that as separate experience and just say, oh, you know what, that was just like, that was just my mind. Like, or, you know, I could talk myself out of that experience. Or you could have the, or you could never take the road of the Magi experience, of walking it out and really studying it out and really looking into who it is. But I think it also shows us, like, every single aspect of our life. There's areas in our lives that we're like shepherds, and we're just like, we're grinding and we're out there and, you know, we're just tending the flock. And there's areas of our lives where we're like, we're king and wise men, and we're the best that there ever was. And both of them have to come to the foot of Jesus. Like, both of them have to bow down. And so it's from that shepherd to that king, and everything in between is to be placed at the foot of Jesus. And at that point, like, it becomes whole for you. Because it's not only the portion that you're really wise about, that you're like, oh, this is Jesus. It's the point, it's the stuff that you're grinding out. You know, it's the hard stuff. It's the shepherding. It's the being out there in the field. That stuff needs to come at the foot too. So I'm just really, I'm really in awe that the Father allows this broad experience between a broad group of people, and then says, well, you know, if it's really for all people, it's for the shepherds and it's for these wise men and the kings, and it all leads to the foot of Jesus.
Just impacting every aspect of... Just how it's impacting every aspect of society and every aspect. It as soon as he was born, every system responded in heaven and earth. The angels responded, and they were shepherds, rulers, kings, everything. And it's you can even see it in the next part. I don't know if we're going to get to the next part of the circumcision and all that, but it's just so incredible that the fulfillment of the law fulfills the law physically. You know, let's go through all the steps. Although I am the fulfillment of the law, I'm going to fulfill the law physically. I am the fulfillment of prophecy, and still I will fulfill prophecy. Simeon and Anna, like, seeing. And it's just amazing how this little baby is completely shaking all the systems, completely creating this ripple effect throughout the world. First of all, everybody is back to their place of origin. Everybody is reconnecting to their roots, because that's what the Father is doing. All the kings are shaking in their boots, like, oh my God, what is happening? This guy's going to take our power, and he's a little tiny baby. You know, all the shepherds are like, you know what, I'm going to leave my flock, and I'm going to see what's happening. It's just things that do not ordinarily have the power to change anything. A little baby being born would not have this kind of impact. So it's just so powerful, all the things that happened just because of this one birth.
I did also find it interesting that, like, the gifts were given by the wise men. And if we look at that portion of our lives, like, so many times we lay our gifts down in the shepherd role out of the excitement thing. And then when the excitement rose up, we're like, oh, you know what, let me give this gift back because it doesn't feel as good anymore. So I'm just going to, like, give this back. But it was actually the wise men that, like, that really studied out like plotted out, thought out process that laid got you to the foot of Jesus. And then when you got to the foot of Jesus, you're like, okay, I have to give you these gifts. Like I'm not giving them out out of like any type of emotional thing. I'm giving out knowing who you are, and yeah, an expanse of who you are, and not just like, well, the angels were doing this, and it was night, and all of a sudden it was light, and all that emotional kind of stuff. We tend to do that. But it gets us weary, right? And we don't sustain that. But through the real, like, walked out experience of who the Father is and who Jesus is and getting to his feet, you're able to lay that down. And you're like, I'm very comfortable with that being laid down there at the foot of Jesus because I know who he is. Like, I know who he is. I don't need to take it back up because I'm worried about what he's going to do with it. Like, I actually need him to have this in order for it to truly fulfill it, even its purpose.
Well, even too, it says like before that they gave him their treasures, they fell down and worshiped him. And so worship being like, that's who we are. Like we are his greatest form of worship. So they gave, like they fell and by honoring him gave themselves first. And then out of that, they gave their gifts.
Let's finish this story, then we'll go back to Luke. When they had gone, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, get up and take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child to destroy him. And so Joseph got up and took the child and his mother while it was still night and left for Egypt. And he remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. Then, when Herod saw that he had been tricked by the Magi, he became very enraged and sent and slew all the male children who were in Bethlehem and all its vicinity, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had determined from the Magi. Then what had been spoken through Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. A voice was heard in Ramah, weeping in great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, and she refused to be comforted because they were no more. But when Herod died, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, get up and take the child and his mother and go into the land of Israel, for those who sought the child's life are dead. So Joseph got up, took the child and his mother, and came into the land of Israel. But when he had heard this guy, Archelaus, was reigning over Judea in the place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And after being warned by God in a dream, he left for the regions of Galilee and came and lived in a city called Nazareth. And this was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophets, that he shall be called a Nazarene. A couple really important thoughts I see here. One of the most simple ones is pay attention to your dreams. I was really reminded as I read through this how, you know, three different times there's a warning in a dream or there's a very important message in a dream. And I think there's real value in us paying attention to how the Lord speaks to us. So let's be intentional, even in our sleep and in our rest. Because, you know, this sonship that's on the inside of us, this son that Mary brought forth, there are authorities and rulers of this present age that want to kill it, to destroy you. But what's interesting is that it's not always, like in our present day life, it's not always as, you know, outlandish as kill all the kids 2 and under. It's oftentimes much more insidious and much more veiled in its, you know, attempt to kill us. It comes through, you know, things that we don't even realize are killing and destroying the son, the daughter on the inside of us. It's things that eventually bring offense or bring apathy or bring, I don't need to be involved in that or whatever it might be. before long, whatever you have experienced in this life will either bring life to your sonship or will attempt to destroy your sonship, to destroy this identity of who you really are. And Herod is just a, in my mind, a symbolic image, a natural version of a spiritual reality that there is something in this earth that wants to destroy that which exists inside of you, that God is bringing forth on the inside of you, to the point where it will kill things around you just in case. Think about this. All of the children, ages 2 and under, you know, it kind of speaks to this, the pervasive, like in my mind, I always try to relate this to current reality, the pervasive spirit of this present age. And it's talked a lot about in the New Testament, specifically in Acts. The apostles often refer to this present age. Paul says it several times too, that the spirit of this present age is really what we're being saved from. It's really important that we understand this. You're not being saved from the devil. You're being saved from a way of life and a mindset and a belief system that will neuter and eventually destroy who you really are. And that's what Herod was. Because the system of this world knows that the reality of who Mary really is inside destroys the curse over the earth. And so the spirit of Herod, so to speak, still exists in 2016, wanting to destroy so that the earth remains in its captivity. And not, let's not think globally, let's just think in your life. So you remain sick. So you remain poor. So you remain under instead of your rightful place of over and ruling in the authority of the nature and character of God.
Yeah, you don't have to kill somebody if you kill their dreams. And if they're operating in that lifeless state, then actually it becomes something working against who they really are. It actually strengthens that opposition by killing your dreams, but letting you live in that shattered state.
Which is worse.
Yeah, it's beautiful, the wording. Out of you shall come forth a ruler who will shepherd. Not a ruler who will rule, a ruler who will, like, you know, dominate, but it's like a ruler who will shepherd, which is Ezekiel 34, about the heart of David, that he would be a shepherd. And again, this to go with what the message that the Lord gave to the shepherds about his heart towards all of mankind. That, and I believe more and more we will see and understand that the heart of the Father, actually he's been telling me this over and over, that he loves all of mankind. He loves believers, non-believers, and every race, every religion, all of that. He wants all of them to have human rights, prosperity, health, all those things. Is not just about believers. It's about all of mankind. So this distinction will become more and more important, that as we become rulers more aware of our authority and our authority grows, this will be one of the main distinctions. Do we only care about believers, or do we care about all of the world? Because it's a big difference in this. Even later, when Simeon is talking to about Jesus, the prophet, he says, a light to the Gentiles and a glory to Israel. And this is where I can see we are the light of the world, but to one another in the family, we are glory. We see the glory of God within, but to the outside, we are light. And this is, sometimes we think we are the light to each other, and it's not true. The Lord is our light, and we are the light of the world. But in each other, we have to see that glory. And I think it's part of this difference, that sometimes we just want to be light, but we don't understand the glory we carry. And that's why, and part of the glory is this, that we are one with the Father, and actually that is the glory, that we are one with the Father. But that glory was given to the family, to sons. And that's the glory that Jesus was carrying, that even when he came, and he came to his own, and he was, when John said, the light came, and we saw the glory. Not the world, but we who were one with him saw the glory. So it's this thing here that I see is when Jesus came, and that glory, even as little as it was in a tiny baby, just that in itself was enough to change all of the structures, all of the systems, because a ruler had come who would be a shepherd, who would not just be about my thing, my little kingdom, but it's like everything, everybody, all of it. And this is such a big difference that even in the church, we have to really shift into caring about all the earth and not just, well, the believers in the church. That's the family. That has a relevance, but we don't just see this. We see all of it. And that's one of the main things that you can see from that. I'm saying this because the Magi were not Israelites, and still they saw the star. They saw the light. They saw the hope. It made a difference to them who had, they were pagan. They had nothing to do, but even they were like, this is a game changer. This is changing everything. And they went to the king because they were like, he's a king. He's probably related to this system here. They were like so convinced what we saw as royalty is the ruler. So they went to the ruler. It was just the wrong type of authority. So, but they were in the right direction. And I feel that as sons, we need to understand who we are. And like Mark was saying, how this really challenges the system of the world and not carry it lightly. I'd be like, oh, well, yeah, I'm a son. Cool. I can be in a family. We have koinonia within each other. It's cool. It's wonderful. It's like that creates a huge impact, and it's a huge threat to the outside. It's also the greatest hope they will ever know. So we kind of balance this where we have to protect the son within, but at the same time, we're not living in isolation from the world. Yes.
I think it's it's really important that it's known that it was for all the earth. But I think it's actually even proven here in that little portion where Jesus, where Joseph takes Jesus and Mary to refuge in Egypt. Because right there, the father is like breaking this geographical idea of us and them. Because, I mean, where did the Jews flee from? Like, that was the whole point. Like, they fled from Egypt and got out of this place. And then for 40 years, they're walking around in a circle that should have taken them a week, maybe less, to walk. And they're still fleeing Egypt at that whole time. And then when Jesus himself needed refuge for his own life as a baby, the father sends him into Egypt, which to us, that would be like, wait, no. That we tried to get out of that place. And there, it's the father's like, first of all, I'm breaking this geographical idea of where you feel like you're going to be safe. And not only am I doing that, you have to understand that I am your refuge. So I'll be your refuge in that place where you have considered it like hostile all your life, like for generation and generation.
The reality
generation
is, where was the hostility?
Yeah. Oh, it was in
The current church of that time. So it was a reverse psychology, not reverse psychology, but he was reversing that. That mindset idea. Which was Egypt was our enemy, so to speak. Yeah, you actually brought protection for the seed.
Yeah, the enemy brought protection for their, was the refuge.
Yeah.
That blows our mind.
What's funny about that is a restoration of their original interaction with Egypt. Before they were,
that's right. They went there to not to die from a famine.
Yeah, that's a big deal.
Very good.
Yeah, it's, again, this us versus them is where I will, when John talks about how the Lord came, it's so interesting because the world came from him and then he came into the world. So it's like this, you know, it's very interesting how the paradox of like, I made you, but now you're going to make me, basically, as a baby. It's very interesting, this inception, cross-inception, but John was like, he came into the world, the light shone in the darkness did not comprehend him. And then it changes. It's talking then, them, and then it says, but we have seen the glory. And again, this, the world will see the light, but we see the glory. Like, if you're within him, you see glory. And from the outside, you see light. So it's like this, what I feel is that once, when we're in him, we have to be more and more aware of this glory that is overshadowing us, and our light will get brighter on the outside. There is, in this sense, an us versus them of those who are in him and those who are not yet in him, in how they perceive the Lord. I remember Max had this dream, that this encounter with the Lord, where the Father was holding Jesus and the Holy Spirit, they were holding hands, and he was like, oh wow, that's a Trinity, amazing. And then the Father is like, come here. And he's like, I can't do that. You're God. I can't just come here and hold you guys' hand. It's three. It's not four. And he's like, do you know who you are? And the Father is like, I know who I am. Do you know who you are? And it's like this. So he said, so, okay. He grabbed the hand, and then more people came, and the circle got bigger and bigger and bigger. And then the Father said, see, it's three in one, four in one, five in one, six in one, you know, we are one. And then what he turned around and he saw all the angels and all the people looking, not the creatures looking from outside, they just saw one. But from within, you could see all the differences. You could distinguish him and him and him, but from the outside, it was just one. So this us versus them, it's that distinction that those who have become one with him, there is no distinction. From the outside, however, there will be a difference in how you perceive the Lord. And you will not comprehend it until you are inside and you're a part of that glory. So that's what I feel so much about the Lord actually birthing us, but then he was birthed by us. As this, you know, let me actually demonstrate in the flesh what it looks like and what it is like.
Any other thoughts on that? Let's go back to Luke 2 then. Verse 21. When 8 days had passed before his circumcision, his name was then called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the days for their purification according to the law of Moses were completed, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male that opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what was said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. And there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, and looking for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child to Jesus to carry out for him the custom of the law, then he took him in his arms and blessed God and said, now, Lord, you are releasing your bondservant to depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples. A light of revelation, this is what Gabby was talking about earlier, to the Gentiles, and the glory of your people Israel. So back to the whole no us or them. He's both now. He's a light to both the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. His father and mother were amazed at the things which were being said about him. Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rise of many in Israel. And here's a key. And for a sign to be opposed. A sword will pierce even your own soul, to the end that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. There was a prophetess, Anna,
the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years and had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, and then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, serving night and day with fasting and prayer. At that very moment, she came up and began giving thanks to God and continued to speak of him to all those who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. And when they had performed everything according to the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own city of Nazareth. The child continued to grow and become strong, increasing in wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. So just a couple key things that I saw, and I want you guys to speak to this too. But I want to go back to what Simeon said to Mary, because this is, for me, it was a picture of Jesus' ministry specifically. He says that, "Behold, this child," verse 34, "is appointed for the fall and rise of many in Israel, and for a sign to be opposed." So in other words, he's actually being brought to earth for opposition. And he actually says later, if you remember, he says, "Look, I didn't come to bring peace to the earth. I've actually come to bring a sword." And he will separate things that need to be separated. You know, the idea that the Prince of Peace is also a sword is like this paradox that Gabby talked about earlier. The Lord himself is an ongoing paradox of our lives. He is both a peacemaker and he's one that creates an incredible disturbance among us. So if you ever think that a disturbance is going on and that means it's not the Lord, I want you to know that's not true. There will be regularly a time where the Lord will show up in your life and you will oppose him. Or he will oppose something in you. Perfectly legitimate. It's who he is. As Gabby was talking about earlier, flesh versus spirit, Jesus will stand against everything that you, any allegiance you have to your flesh, Jesus, just by the nature of who he is, will oppose it. He's not trying to be your enemy, but he comes to bring a sword. He will come and, you know, if a mother and a daughter, one believes and one doesn't, I'll separate them. I will bring about a division. And even though for us today, especially in kind of Western ooey-gooey Christianity, oh, Jesus would never separate a mother and a daughter. Yeah, he would. He would if it meant that one would be able to walk fully in their purpose and identity, where one is continuing to spurn the Spirit. He does that in the New Testament. He does it in his own ministry, and he still does it today. If your allegiance is to something other than a Lord, the natural result in the presence of the Lord is opposition. It's not the Lord trying to oppose. It's just who he is. And as a result, there will be a rise of some and a fall of some. Simply because of the presence of Emmanuel, God with us. And I've seen this in my own life. I've seen it in the church. I've seen it in the kingdom of God at large. I've seen the Lord begin to show up and really be himself. And some are rejoicing like an Anna and a Simeon. And some are like, this is not God. You've probably experienced it in your own life, where the Lord begins to work in you and speak into you. And your sonship begins to get realized. And there are some in your life that rejoice. And there are some that think you're nuts. And they're both accurate responses. And because that is, if you think about, there were more people opposed to Jesus in Israel than there were for him. And there were more people for him in the world than there were opposing him. It was this strange dynamic that was going on.
Even in his own family, you could see how Joseph and Mary and the natural sons were always like, "What are you doing, Jesus? You're embarrassing the family." The whole time they were there, and he, until he was like, "Who is my family? This is my family." Like, he did it. He doesn't do it to us. He experienced it himself. He went through it, and that will be the requirement every time. It's like that. His real family. He wasn't saying, "Oh, that's not. That's his natural family. That's the blood, the flesh and blood." But his real family is those who are born of the Father, because that's where he came from. That's his first family. That's the real bloodline. And it's not that he wants to, like, oh, that doesn't matter. It does matter. But that's not really who he is. Like, it's, he's not bound by the flesh as much as he's bound by the spirit. So it's like, it's just not, that's not really who I am. And now my, why I'm amazed with Jesus is that he never, ever, he learned, he grew, he had many people pouring into his life, but he always knew who he was. And it's the shocking thing to me that everything Jesus did came from, this is who I am. I might, and I wonder if he always knew what he was doing. Maybe he didn't, but I think he always knew it was him. It's like he could not get to the point of not knowing, not being able to say, I am. I am. I'm a father, son. This is who I am. I mean, even to his parents when he was 12, was like, what do you mean? I'm after doing, this is my father's business. Why would you think I would be anywhere else? This is who I am. At 12, he already knew. And I don't think anybody told him. It's just, this is who I am. This is my identity. It's always been within me. I'm just releasing it. And that creates this huge opposition and tension with people whose identities are dictated by a number of things that come from the flesh. Money, power, religion, culture, tradition, all of that. It's just the way it is. This is my main identity. This is where I flow. And it's going to be always, like, you know, breaking the relationship with everything else, because that is so important for people in the world. And he's just like, but this is who I am. I'm just being myself. And that's just...
Other thoughts? I feel like we're just doing a lot of talking here. You guys aren't sharing. What do you guys think?
So now, are we saying that the Spirit of God is diametrically opposed to the spirit of the world, and that's what we're up against? Or is that what we're saying here? Is that, can that be corroborated by the Word and by what we know to be true? Diametrically opposed to this world system and thought and how we live, because if we're not born of the Spirit, we're born of something else. And it's diametrically opposed. This is what brings on problems. And this is why we attend classes like this, because we need to understand what comes against us and why and that kind of thing. And how we, you know, use it as a anchoring in a greater understanding. Is that what we're saying?
Yeah, as long as we can separate the spirit of this world from the people of this world. Because I think we have to go back to the beginning. He still has goodwill toward man. So God's goodwill toward man will remain and always remain to the point where Emmanuel, God with us, I'll never leave you or forsake you. It's Holy Spirit upon all the world, convicting them of sin, righteousness, and judgment. However, the flesh of man still exists. And I believe the flesh of man is in partnership with the spirit of this world, like you said. So in that case, that's when the Spirit comes, similar to this verse here, and a sword will pierce even your own soul to the end that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. I think the goal there is not just so that, all your secret thoughts, Leslie, now we know them. No, it's so that we can see, oh my goodness, these things that are coming up from the inside, that's not who I really am. I think it's actually to reveal the nature of what we're actually acting in and living by and speaking from versus like this newness of life that's showing up in our life in the name of Jesus. So I think diametrically opposed, if you want to use that terminology, yeah, I think he's diametrically opposed to the spirit of this world, as long as we can separate that from the people, because I still think he's for them. He still sees them in their original identity. His the kind intention of his will is to adopt them as sons. So as long as we can say that, then I'm in agreement with that, yeah.
So just something that I saw in the parts about the purification, and I'd seen that, I'd read that before, but I didn't really understood what that meant. And it goes back to in Leviticus, where they're talking about what happens when you have a child. And I think it's just great the way that the father is just willing to turn things up, I guess, or turn things on end, and how the way we think it's going to happen isn't really how it happens. So in that, you're not supposed to, the woman that gave birth is not supposed to touch, not even touch anything holy for 33 days. And like, you know, she's a mama, and you know that she's holding the Lord as soon as she's given birth, and like she's touching the holiest of holies. I thought that was really amazing. The other thing is, when you were talking earlier about how she was still a virgin, you know, so in marriage, that's one of the things, that's one of those covenant things. And I think we talked about it before, or somebody shared that with us before, how when a couple was married, to display the covenant of the marriage, and that, you know, she was a virgin, they would hang the sheets up to display that. And it's so beautiful that this covenant came from the inside, that, you know, the Christ within us, the covenant was from the inside out, not from the outside in. It's beautiful.
Any other thoughts you guys might be having?
I don't want to hit the rewind button too much, but I keep coming back to what Ben was saying about, you know, the two different experiences between the shepherds and then the Magi. And I don't know, I just keep finding it interesting that the Magi come, I mean, if you read it in the scripture, it almost seems like they come 2 years after the birth of Christ. And it seems like the shepherds get to experience it like right then, and they experience it pretty shortly after Christ is born. The Magi don't come until almost two years later, or around that point. I don't know. I'm wondering, like, what happened between that time that no one knows where Jesus is. I mean, I know he's just a baby, but I think it goes back to just to kind of prove what, and just reinforce what Ben was saying, was that, I mean, the Magi came from, I'm not sure how far away. I was actually trying to research a little bit to see if there's anything definitive. I couldn't find anything. But they come from however far away, and they're following a star that obviously no one else sees for almost 2 years. That just kept like bubbling up inside me that, you know, there's something to be said about the subtlety of a star that only three guys saw, that they were so focused, and they knew what they were supposed to do, to the point where they were willing to follow this star for 2 years before they actually got to meet the king. I don't know. I think that speaks a lot for the two experiences, that I think there's something awesome about the shepherd experience, but I think there's even something more awesome and something more lasting about the Magi experience, and that experience of just putting in the labor, you know, putting in the time that it takes to be able to leave your gifts there, because you're okay with it. You know, you're okay with the gifts being where they're supposed to be.
I love that. The idea of persevering for the better part of 2 years
for the reward. Mm-hmm. Following just a star, just a sign to actually see. Yeah, I think it's really good.
I think that whole thing speaks so much to what wisdom really is. If you think of like the wise men and just, I think no one, I mean, they were just out following and no one really knew what they were out there doing it. They were just kind of like underground.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They weren't being seen. They weren't being present. They were just
not acting wise.
No, kind of not. No one would necessarily think that they were. Right. But I just think that really, you had a really good point that speaks so much to what wisdom really is.
Really looks like.
Yeah.
You have a footnote that said that they were actually astronomers, like they were scientists, like they were learned men. And I think it's kind of interesting that nowadays most scientists and learned people don't even believe this story. And I don't know, I just saw kind of, you know, for I saw kind of bridging that between the people who just accept it and the people who are the, you know, the learned people, the wise men, the astronomers who, you know, nowadays probably wouldn't, you know, not all of them, but a bulk of the scientific community thinks that this is a load of crap and a fairy tale.
Right.
Yeah, I love the paradox about the one who holds the whole world in his hands being held by his parents, the one who's the father of all mankind being fathered by us, the one we came from him and then he came from us. This whole thing is just keeps going back. He is the temple and he's been presented in the temple. He is the fulfillment of prophecy and then he is prophesied over as like... Which is why John was almost like, you should be the one doing this. Why am I doing this? But like how he became one of us to the point that the God himself, the Godhead, you know, allowed himself to go through all these stages of things that actually he is, but he received from us as much as in the end he gave to us is like he allowed himself to receive from us. Diapers changed, you know, meals made. All these things that is just the humility, but also the thanksgiving and the just the simplicity, you know, of emptying himself to the point of receiving from mankind, which actually everything we have came from him. We received from him, but he was receiving from us. And it just keeps going. Even the gift that the Magi were bringing is probably like, oh, okay, thank you. I own the universe, but all right. You know, like, it's just so crazy that even when he was saying, like, yeah, I could defend myself. I could just ask for legions of angels, you know, but I'm not going to. It's like that concept that he has everything and yet he left it all just to experience what we experience. And it's never so dramatic as when you actually see this little tiny baby just helpless because physically he could do nothing on his own. And it's just so every time I think about that, it's like that's God, you know, that's like God. And then it was just really amazing to me, this whole thing. But the more I think about it, I feel if we actually came from him, he created a way from there to here, but when he came here, he created the way from here to there. So now we have the path, the living path that he opened just by coming and going back, because otherwise it would be just like one way, just him giving, but now it's actually we're exchanging.
Yeah, I was thinking about that in terms of his authority and how in most cases we would say that someone has authority because they wield it and prove it by using it. And I mean, to be overly simplistic, you know, I'm thinking about 2.5-year-old Jesus. You know, it says that he was increasing in wisdom. And yet all of the authority was on the inside of this 2.5-year-old child. He wasn't having to wield it in order to have it. And even as he got older and he became someone that was facing Pilate or facing even just, you know, questioning, he wielded his authority in such a submissive way that is humbling to me, because I still, and I think many of us feel this way and think this way, we need to start changing our perspective of what it means to honor people. Because oftentimes our honor is still based upon the position, the authority, and the ability for someone to carry that authority. And Jesus didn't wield 0.5% of all the authority he had. He knew when was the right time to exercise it, and in almost every case, he exercised it for the benefit of all mankind and not for himself. And too many times, the authority that we have is used to bring health and wellness and whatever it might be to ourselves. And for me, it's like when that authority given by the Lord is used for the goodwill toward all men, that's when it becomes real authority. And Jesus manifests this over and over again. You know, this, the King of all kings living inside 2.5-year-old body, you know, and at 12 years old, we can go on to the rest of that story of Luke 2 and talk about at 12 years old. They're all like, where the heck are you? You should know where I am. I'm in my father's house, and still goes back and submits himself to his parents. You know, so this constant, it's almost as if the true measure of your authority is how well you can submit it to a lesser one. And not have to overarch every other authority that might be lesser than you. So,
think about that. Like, Jesus learned carpentry from Joseph.
I mean, like you were saying, like I'm the creator of all things. I could probably show you how to do that, or I could snap my fingers and that thing exists. But in order for me to honor you as my father, I'm going to submit myself. This is Jesus submitting himself to Joseph to learn this thing, this trade. Like, that's an honor that I don't think that we afford each other at all. Like, I know better. I know. Don't worry about it. Like, I got this. But to truly, like, come under someone, like Jesus would come under Joseph and say, yes, teach me this thing that you know so that I can learn from you, even though I have everything in me.
Right, yeah, the Lord being presented to the Lord.
Well, I think, Ben, this is one thing that I love about, because I feel like he's constantly showing us how to be human over and over. Like, that's, in my mind, when I read, that's the biggest thing as I grasp is, like, I feel like Jesus came, one of his biggest things was to teach us how to be human and how to live human. Because, like, when I just try to follow Jesus in his divinity, I can't relate all the way, because I'm here human trying to live here, and I'm trying to live divine human. So there's, like, a disconnect. I'm just speaking within me personally. So when I can relate to Jesus as a man and look at how he modeled how to live here, human, like, I absolutely can relate and understand and connect a lot better.
Yeah, I always thought that those 30 years that he just learned to be human, because he knew how to be God. That was... You know, so he had to learn. And we kind of need to do the opposite. We know how to be human, and we need to learn how to be with the thing we lost in the garden. We need to go back to that. So it's like the opposite. And I think we meet somewhere in the middle, that where he understands us and we start understanding him, so we can be one, both in the as Son of God and as Son of Man. But it's so interesting that when he went through those 30 years of just learning to be human, the Father was like, I am so pleased in you. It's like, this is why you came. And it's like, you're amazing. You're so human right now. It's like, you know, I'm so pleased.
Really important. How did
And this is an overly simplistic question, but there's a point to it. How did God learn to be human? So he literally lived inside human flesh. So how does a human learn to become a son of God? Live inside of the Lord himself. So, you know, it's one thing to live according to the model that Jesus presented. It's another thing to literally live inside of him and to allow him to live inside of us. And so, you know, it's a memorized verse from Sunday schools and from Christian schools and all that, but it's so important. It is no longer I that live, but it's Christ that lives in me. That is such an important thing because Jesus almost did the opposite. It's no longer me as God, but it's me as humanity. And that's why I am fully convinced there's a man on the throne. There's a man on the throne now. And as a result of a man being on the throne, I believe Jesus can fully say, there's God on the earth. But the way we learn it is not to just simply follow teachings and follow examples, but to let him live in us. And to us to live in him, the overshadowing, and that the overshadowing is the becoming from within us.
God is really, really in me, and I just can't be rude and mean to people. That's God in my heart. I mean, when I walk somebody by somebody, my first instinct is to say hello to them. Even a stranger, hi, how are you doing? And that's God inside me. And like I said, with my blindness, he allowed it for his glory to help others, to help me. He's living inside of me, and me going over to the homeless shelter every other week, it's helping them.
Jason, I don't know if you realize that is the whole point.
Yeah.
The reason why you struggle to be rude and mean to people is because the nature of God is on the inside of you. And
the good things. I mean, and I was asking them questions, and what I'm going to do is, not tomorrow night, but Joyce gave me the names of the people, or Kendall gave them to Joyce, and then Joyce, the next time I go over to the shelter, what I'm going to do is, my mom's going to read people's names, and then I'm going to put their names in Braille. Alphabet and the numbers just 0 through 9 in a row. So I'm going to take it over in 2 weeks and read it to them, do like a demo, like show them how like I read like Braille and stuff.
That's pretty cool, Jason. Thank you, man.
All right. Thanks for being here tonight, guys. And we are having that our Christmas gathering on Friday night, 7 o'clock. Oh, yeah.